Thank you, thank you, thank you. Open your Bibles, if you will, please, to Luke's Gospel, chapter 6. Luke's Gospel, chapter 6, and we're going to begin reading in verse 20. Luke's Gospel, chapter 6, and verse 20. Through verse 26.
And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for ye shall be filled. Blessed are ye that weep now, for ye shall laugh. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice ye in that day, and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. For in the like manner did their fathers unto the prophets. But woe unto you that are rich, for ye have received your consolation. Woe unto you that are full, for ye shall hunger. Woe unto you that laugh now, for ye shall mourn and weep. Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you, for so did the fathers to the false prophets.
Let's pray. Father, I love you and thank you for tonight. And Lord, you have given us a formula for life on this earth as you would want us to live. Help us to understand, receive, and Lord, then put into action that which you have taught us and trained us to do. We'll pray all this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, Amen. The Beatitudes, the attitudes that should be. Not a bad way to start the new year. Not a bad way to put into our hearts and minds what the Lord wants out of us while we're stationed here on planet Earth. How about that? Now, I mean, everybody in the room brought in one thing that only you can choose for yourself. Listen to this. It's your attitude. Kind of touched on this in the auditorium class, the book of Philippians. Brother John Duggar, pray for Jean Duggar. She had surgery on her foot. And John and Jean are not, they had to stay out at the Duggar Ranch today, convalescing, and might have to for another week, but pray for Jean Duggar. But that gave me an opportunity to teach this morning in auditorium class, and I mentioned about the choosing of our attitude for a new year. And Philippians, the book of Philippians, is all about attitude and heart. The mind you would choose. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. There isn't any greater example or teacher or pattern for the way to think than to study the life of Jesus. And that mind, the Holy Spirit of God in us, would put into us, each of us, listen to this, each of us would have the same mind. How about that? Wouldn't that be, if everybody's on the same page, and everybody had just chose to have the mind of Christ and chose to say, as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. Let that be your motto for the year. And our, of course, our theme for the year. Now, many of you, we choose a theme for the year. And our theme for this year is love like Christ. Love like Christ. We're going to emphasize loving like Christ throughout our church and for this year. And you'll see banners and different things. We just didn't get them delivered in time, but we'll have banners up and some other graphics and different things. That and by the way, you'll have T-shirts for the year, right, Dave? You'll have those available, I don't know when, but... Workers' Banquet, that's it. That's where we'll kind of launch out into this. So we're just looking at what is commonly referred to as the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes. This is Luke's, what I would call kind of a shorter version. His notes, if you will please, are a little bit more condensed. Matthew chapter 5, where it's expanded, and we'll touch on that just a little bit. But we'd simply have entitled the message tonight, A New Blessing for a New Year. Now, it's not really that, we're not inventing or even suggesting that there's any new blessings, but if you've never experienced the blessing of living through the Beatitudes, then this will be a blessed year for you. Now, the thought of the word blessing, I use it a lot, but to the Jewish people, to the Jewish mind, that word evoked images of, a long life. To receive the blessing of the Lord would be one where they would think, I'm going to have a long life, or wealth, or a large, healthy family, a full barn, and enemies that are defeated. I mean, that would be a life to the Jewish mind. That would be considered a life well blessed. But really, it really focuses too much on the temporal. The blessings that the Lord wants to give us are spiritual. Now, they do, I believe there are connecting dots to serving the Lord and receiving what we would call, even on earth, blessings materially. I believe there's evidence in Scripture that as you serve the Lord from your heart and honor Him with your substance, and you give to the Lord from your time, talent, and treasure. Did you hear that? Hello, Christian. Three areas that you give. Time. That's really important. You're here tonight. You have given your time to park your carcass on a pew and listen to the Word of God. Now, that's a good thing. I'm gonna pat you on the back tonight. Everybody in the room. You get your attaboys tonight. Whether I say it or not, it depends on what your heart is sitting in that pew, right? You can have an ill heart and sit in a pew, and it won't do you any good if nothing changes. So tonight we're going to look at these Beatitudes, the attitudes that should be, the attitude that should be in our hearts. Now, here's how you invite. I always tell people, you need to invite God's blessings on your life. You need to align with Scripture to do that. This morning I went and visited the Bakke family yesterday at their home. They've been visiting for a while, and Steve is in his 50s, and his wife, they're in their mid-50s, you might say, and they're good people. But they had never, in 30-something years of marriage, ever had the same church home. It had never really become and folks, listen, this can happen in people's lives where time goes by in a marriage or in a life. Saved at an early age, Steve gave testimony about being saved at, and some of you are from the Laverty Church, and you might have even known Steve from way back. He was there. Phyllis, he was talking about you being his bus driver and knowing you at Pioneer, different place. Well, I'm not going to go there. You knew Steve when he was growing up. See, I didn't. I just know him here now. But Steve talked about you and fond memories and then he was saved and baptized at Laverty, and then I guess just time went by, as does in life. And did you know their son, Chad, has been attending this church for quite some time? And I'm not so sure it wasn't you guys that got him to think about coming. Is that right? I don't know, how long ago was that, that Chad started coming? Yeah, he has. And they come, he comes occasionally, but you see how these dots start connecting and people start, you know, and they started attending. And then I saw them one day entering the building, well, it was just the week before, Steve and Kelly is her name. And I said, boy, I'd sure like to come. Oh, we'd love to have you come visit. So when I come and visited and got to talking to him, and of course every time I always like to just get down to the real issue, are you saved? And both of them said they were saved. He gave the testimony of being saved and baptized at Laverty, but just hadn't really served the Lord in his life. You know, he works for the railroad now and has for about 10 years or so. And he's just started coming. And then his wife, Kelly, she has a background from growing up in a Church of Christ. But she knows she's saved. I asked her point blank about her salvation. She knew she was saved and ready for heaven. But to join our church, it'd be by baptism and to be a part of our church fellowship. And she was just so happy to do that and ready to do that this morning, you know. What I'm saying is people live a lifetime and now they're signed up for next step. They were eager to do that, Brother Kent. I mean, I mentioned that yesterday to them, and they said, we've never been a part of something where somebody taught us. We've been coming and hearing your preaching, and we enjoy your preaching. Did you hear me? I said they enjoyed my preaching. They enjoyed my preaching. They enjoyed my preaching. They enjoyed, I don't know how that got stuck. Somehow that got stuck, Brother Ed. I don't know why. Some people actually enjoy my preaching. Don't worry about it. You know, if there ever were an ego to stroke in this room, I guarantee you by the time I stepped off the platform, there'd be enough people saying, you are just, yeah. That comes from Shirley all the time. But, you know, there's people like this all over Chickasha and Grady County. There are people that are just waiting to start their spiritual journey. And they've been on this earth for a while. There's lots of young couples. I visited another family yesterday, and I got a meal out of them. I like that. I do. I'm glad I got fed. I really, you know, I need help with food. You see, I'm famished all the time. But I got to go into their home and talk to them, and they're looking us over, and there's other families, you know. This is how this works, is God is bringing to us families and people that are interested in getting on a spiritual journey. Dave, I noticed on your desk you must have put out Love Like Christ, and you had your class write down, and I don't know what was all on that. Give an example of what things, and make it loud enough, stand up. Well, you don't have to stand up. It hurts. I know it hurts. He has a foot injury. Amen. Yeah. And I actually read over some of them. I stood there at your desk and read over some. I thought, very interesting, you know, a reflection. And you didn't ask for names. But that comes to every person's heart. The Beatitudes that we're reading tonight have to do with an attitude. You choose this attitude. These aren't rules and regulations. You know the Christian life? Did you know it's a scriptural possibility? Now listen, for you to be saved, okay, let me pose it like this. What is required for you to enter into heaven? What is required? What's required? What's the requirement? What does the Word of God say? What is it that you must do in order to go to heaven? Be born again. Ms. York, you are stellar. You are an example. I do not know. I was asking Kent, Mark, I said, what if we could mix this DNA of Ms. York and pour it into everybody in the church, this would be the happiest. I would walk in, I think everybody's drunk. You're so happy. But she is the happiest person. You ever get around anybody happier than her? I'm asking the question, have you? First of all, she's happy. She laughs. She's always been like this. Does everybody know that? If you don't know Ms. York, you need to get to know her. Right. Okay. But she is. And to give us that answer just like that, thank you so much. That's what this is all about. The only requirement is to be born again. You must be born again. So then, let me ask you this. If you are saved, is it a possibility that you do nothing else and you still get to go to heaven? Everybody shaking their head, yes, right? Because it's true. In fact, 1 Corinthians chapter 3 talks about being saved yet so as by fire. You can be saved and not turn a tap for the rest of your existence. So this is what the Beatitudes began to put into our hearts. Jesus teaching, he's teaching about while you're here, what attitude you should have, first of all, towards circumstances. Towards circumstances. So what does he say? Go back to the first scripture that we started out with. How does he teach this? He lifted up his eyes on his disciples. That's those who are saved. Just and here's our disciple. Sunday night is primarily, I'm pretty well confident the majority of our folks that are here tonight are saved. I could consider you as disciples, right? You're learning. That's why I hope you understand. Sunday morning, you'll hear a lot more evangelistic messages. In other words, to the lost, than you would on a Sunday night or Wednesday night. On a Sunday night, I then go into scripture like this, and we'll take the word of the Lord, and we'll go to the Christian heart and try to teach and train you about your life on planet Earth. But here's the Lord's words. He's talking to his disciples. He lifted up his eyes. This is the Sermon on the Mount. And he says, blessed be ye poor. So, wait a minute. That's kind of contrary to what the Jewish mind was. The Jewish mind thought, well, long life, wealth, large family, healthy family, full barn, and defeated enemies. That'd be a blessing, no? Jesus said, blessed are ye poor. Blessed be ye poor, for yours, look at this, is the kingdom of God. Okay. Brother Kim, wait a minute. Scratch your head right now and just go, oh, what does that mean? Are you telling us to go sell everything we got and be poor and we'll make it into heaven? No. Folks, listen. This is so disconnected from your thoughts of rules and regulations. I've got to do this in order to be in heaven. These are the things I've got. No. And these aren't just suggestions, okay? These are life attitudes. And so you'll see this. But it appears to the common mind, that poverty, hunger, sadness, persecution, isolation, and being falsely accused are seemingly a recipe for the Christian life. If you're going to be a real follower of Christ, you need to have poverty, hunger, sadness, persecution, isolation, and be falsely accused. That's what he's going to talk about here. So does that mean that if I'm not reflecting that in my life, somehow I'm not a follower of Christ? Jesus, in preaching to his disciples and talking to them, all the multitudes, the Lord explained in this particular sermon that a truly blessed life comes from, listen, not getting, and from not doing, but from, listen to this, from being. In other words, this will be your attitude and your disposition for life. You're going to have it's going to change and revolutionize the way you process life and living on this earth, because you're not here for your job. Do you hear that? It's not, life on this earth isn't, okay, I've got to go to work. I've got to get a job. Everybody places so much priority on stuff and things and houses and land. And Jesus comes to disconnect us from the material side of life and help us to understand all of that is just there. 100 years from tonight, is that going to matter? Is it going to amount to anything when you stand before the Lord and say, Lord, I had all this stuff I accumulated while I was on earth, and all you're going to hear is crickets, if that's all you live for, if there's any crickets in heaven. But really, I mean, it doesn't. You've got to be reprogrammed in your heart and mind. Jesus came to this earth and he lived for others, and he lived for the higher purpose, for the real meaning of life on planet Earth. And the real meaning of life on planet Earth, number one, we've already identified it, is to come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. If you've got that, you're already as good as there. Okay, so the rest of this is fill in the blanks, but it really makes a big difference how you fill in the blanks. It really does make a difference how you personally choose your life. Life's like a smorgasbord. And you get to choose, because everybody in this room chooses differently. Now, I mean, we're kind of all the same, but then we're different, aren't we? I mean, we just are. We have different tastes. We have different likes and dislikes. We have different... All of that's just being human. But then there's very specific teaching about the Christian attitude and disposition and how are we going to communicate God's love to a lost and dying world. How are we going to do this? Well, he said, blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are ye that hunger now. Now, Matthew kind of expands on both of these thoughts. Remember, Matthew said, blessed are ye that hunger after righteousness. See, there's some added information. Luke kind of gives you the condensed version, if you will. It's not that he omits anything. It's just that this is Luke's. Dr. Luke, he's probably just thinking, well, they've got that. The Holy Spirit of God gave him this, right? But when you connect back to Matthew's gospel, where the same word says, those that hunger after righteousness, now you kind of get it. So the attitude of hungering isn't about physical food. And the idea of being poor is poor in spirit. In other words, not proud. Pride is the enemy of the Christian life, of anybody's life. So when you consider that he's talking about attitude, which is pride. Now we have, but pride keeps you from doing so much. How are we to walk before the Lord? Humbly. We are to humble ourselves. See, it's an attitude. It's a heart. And these are the things that we have to incorporate into our lives on a daily basis. You know, life was different when the Lord was on earth. I don't think it was quite like it was now. Do you? I don't think it was such a... it was an agronomous society. In other words, if you worked in the field and it was more agricultural and more about laying up and going to the ant and watching how they... And everything was about for the... preparing for the winter and preparing for the next season and then planting and all of these things. It was all about the agriculture and the preparation and the water sources. It was a lot simpler than it is now. Nobody sat down and watched the Cowboys lose a game to the to the Eagles, you know. Nobody watched that, you know. Nobody sat down and had air-conditioned homes and all these things and cars and trains and boats and planes and all that. I think we may be in a vacuum sometimes. But listen, folks, the same Lord wants us. We are uniquely positioned in a culture and a society that we are the light of the world. And we need to choose to be the salt of the earth. That's what Jesus said. He said, here's an attitude. You're the salt. If the salt has lost its savor, if it's lost its flavor, if it's lost its influence, it's good for nothing. It didn't matter what's going on in the world. How about we as Christians? What are we going to do? How are we going to react? How are we going to act? How are we going to talk to folks? How are we going to present Christ? And get it Christ-centered rather than me-centered. It's just an attitude, folks. It's just a choice. And we have to make that choice. So the first thing he addresses are the circumstances of life. The circumstances. You know, people, they, just like today, people thought that happiness came from having great, massive amounts of possessions or holding some influential position or enjoying pleasures or popularity that money could buy. Imagine how surprised they were when Jesus described happiness in terms just the total opposite. They are. I mean, what Jesus taught was the total opposite of what the world was telling them. And that's the truth for you and I in this room. The philosophy of the world is get all you can all you get, sit on the lid and knock off anybody that gets close to it. I mean, it's just a dog-eat-dog world, you know. And you've got to get ahead in this world. You got to grab a root and growl. You got to do it yourself, you know. Be a real man and a real woman. Jesus came and he taught different, totally just the opposite. Blessed are the people that are blessed are those that are poor or humble in spirit. For yours is the kingdom of God. Those that have humbled. No proud sinner has ever been saved. No. You got to humble yourself at the cross. You've got to humble yourself, admit yourself a sinner. Come before God humbly and ask him to save you. That has to happen. And so this is the opposite of what the world was teaching and telling them. He said in verse 21, blessed are ye that hunger now, and are for ye shall be filled. You'll be so full when you hunger after righteousness. The real meat of this world is found in Christ. That's where the real deal is. Blessed are ye that weep now, for you shall laugh. Folks, you shed tears for souls, you'll come rejoicing, bringing your reward with you. Verse 22, you'll be blessed. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you. In other words, what you've done is did they hate Christ? Huh? In his day, did they hate Christ? Did Jesus love them? He sure did. From a cross. Remember what he said? Father, forgive them. The men and women that hated him. Here's his attitude. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And he still loved. And the evidence of love is found in this room. Do you think you were lovely? You are something special tonight that you were just so lovely. The fact is, one sin would send you to an eternal hell. You have offended God many times, multiple times. You're a multiple offender. You have offended many times a holy God. We're nothing really special. We're just very highly favored, and we have been shown the favor of a king, and his son, Jesus Christ, has shown to us mercy and forgiveness, and that's what then he in turn wants us to show this world. Do you hear this? He wants us to emulate and to have as our pattern his son, Jesus Christ. Now that would be good for everybody in this room to just consider the thought of just loving like Christ. The circumstances, the inner attitude that we have, everything matters when it comes to our attitude. So our attitude towards circumstances is very, very important. Jesus, he was not glorifying, listen, he was not glorifying material poverty. He was calling for a broken heart that confesses spiritual poverty. You've got to understand, you come humbly before the Lord, and he will lift you up. A humble person is the only kind of person that can be. Isaiah chapter 57 and verse 15, what does that say? Isaiah 57 and verse 15, very obvious, Isaiah would write, "For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to receive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite." So what is it that the Lord does in chapter 66 and verse 2 of Isaiah? Look at this. "Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that ye build unto me, and where is the place of my rest?" Look at verse 2. "For all those things hath my hand made, and all those things have been, saith the Lord. But to this man will I look." He's looking for this man. He's looking for this person. "Even to him that is poor and of contrite spirit, and," listen to this, "and trembleth at my word." When's the last time God's word moved you to tremble? You remember when you got saved? I remember the trembling. You know why I trembled? Because the preacher preached, old W.W. Baker. And of course, Brother Jack York, many messages. It all accumulated. My Sunday school teachers and people that were in my life, all of it came to bear on a September night, on a Friday night, in a revival in 1967. And it all came to focus in my heart and mind. And I trembled at the word of the Lord. I did not want to die and go to hell. I did not want to die and go to hell. I got saved because I didn't want to go to hell. Now there may be other reasons, but that's a good enough reason, I think, right there to be saved. And I'm glad I got saved. I'm glad I know I have heaven as my home when I die. But I'm not good enough. I didn't do it by my works, by his work. I depend on him. And the Beatitudes are for life after salvation, while you're here. But he takes the humble and the contrite spirit. Someone who is trembling at his word. That's Holy Spirit conviction. There will not be one person saved until the Holy Spirit of God, what? Draws them. That wooing, that drawing. And I sense that many times when I have talked to people. They are under conviction of the Holy Spirit. You can sense that. You're a soul winner. You've been right there. You know about it. And you sense that person is ready to be saved. And that's the Holy Spirit conviction that comes to a person. Let's go back to Luke's gospel. We've got just a few minutes, and we'll take all I'm going to get through is the circumstances. We may come back to this as we preach, but look. Blessed are ye, verse 22, blessed are ye when men shall hate you and when they shall separate you from their company and shall reproach you and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Now this is Christ-like. A Christ-like attitude. In other words, my disposition and my attitude toward the world I live in. I recognize with spiritual eyes, this is a temporary scene. No matter what men say, no matter what happens on earth, it's okay. Who brings vengeance? Who? The Lord. I don't even have to fight the battle. There's no battle I have to engage in. The spiritual battle I engage in by preaching and teaching God's Word and living it out in my life to the best of my ability. And I'm a faulted and flawed man on this earth. I still put leather on clay feet today. My feet are as clay as yours. I'm just dirt like everybody else. And if you don't think so, look at my collar. I'm going to tell you, there's dirt on my collar every single time I wear them. We're just clay. We're just a clay jar, a house for our soul, and we're transporting our soul around until the last breath. That's all we are. And then when he says, these are the kinds of things that are going to happen. Now he says in verse 23, rejoice ye that in that day, and leap for joy. Boy, I'm telling you what, this sounds good. What does he say? Behold, your reward is great. Where? Where? Now he's getting us to look up and look beyond this temporal scene, this earthly scene, this where you're in that clay body. He says, hey, class. Look beyond this scene. This isn't the forever home we're in. This is the temporary stop. You just got tents here. Your mansion's on the other side. Your mansion's way beyond the blue. So the worst that it gets here, men hate you. They talk about you because you're serving Christ. Count it glory. And gosh, if you're considered In the same breath, you're being reviled or ridiculed or whatever men's words. So what? Sticks and stones will break my bone. But words will never hurt me. They're just kids, you know. Well, it's true. But boy, we let things get under our skin so quick. We're human. We don't like people saying this or doing that, right? For in the like manner did their fathers unto the prophets. Jesus said, they're going to talk about you. They did that to the prophets, about the prophets. They did that about me, Jesus. He says, your reward's great in heaven. Just look ahead. It's okay. These are the attitudes that we need to have. When it comes to life on this earth, have the attitude, first of all, of gratitude. We ought to thank the Lord every day that we're His, that we're His youngins, that we're children of the King. And our homes in heaven. I'm telling you, just look ahead. Look forward. Have a forward look. And you're going to be in better shape for 2017. And we're going to talk about loving like Christ real soon. We're going to have a message. All of these things we'll bring out. But that's what we're going to do this year. We're going to try to love like Christ. Are you glad you're here tonight? Say amen. Some of you are just a little bit not here. You know, you're saying, I'm here, but I'm not. Let's stand together. Thank you for coming. I hope it just blessed you a little bit. Hope it opened your heart to the possibility of an attitude in this particular day that we live. Doug Black, your blessing. Lead us in dismissal prayer. Thank you, brother. God bless you. Good to see you. Pew movers. Dave, how many of them? You know which ones? You got it. I just had a, folks, I hope you understand. I've got, my back hurts tonight and my leg. I don't know what it is, but I'm going to have to depend on somebody else maybe.